Yes. May it please the court, this is a Social Security case in which the ALJ made step 5 findings unsupported by substantial evidence. Specifically, appellant submitted vocational expert rebuttal evidence and requested a supplemental hearing. The ALJ rejected that request for a supplemental hearing and stated he found contradictory evidence from the Bureau of Labor Statistics, but failed to proffer that evidence or offer a valid website to visit or find that information. Now, there are several parts of this issue. First, did the evidence reach the level necessary to allow for rejection of appellant's rebuttal evidence? Second, did the ALJ err in not proffering that evidence? And third, what options did the ALJ have available to him instead that he could have chosen from? Now, while there are circumstances that do allow for an ALJ to make a vocational determination without the help of a vocational expert, the ALJ in this case determined that it would be necessary to get that testimony and to see if work existed in significant numbers in the national economy that appellant would be capable of performing. After receiving this testimony from the vocational expert, appellant's representative questioned the source of the numbers offered by the vocational expert. After the hearing, appellant's representative submitted additional rebuttal evidence from one of vocational expert sources, which contradicted the numbers offered by the vocational expert. At this point, the ALJ accepted the evidence submitted by appellant's representative would be sufficient to rebut that determination raised by the vocational expert. As such, the ALJ did go seeking additional evidence that would resolve the conflict raised by appellant's rebuttal. The ALJ did recognize that the burden had shifted back to him. Now, regarding the first part, the evidence offered by the appellant was both significant and probative. Specifically, the evidence itself directly contradicted the findings of the vocational expert and cast serious doubt as to the validity of the job numbers offered at the hearing. As such, at a minimum, the ALJ must explain his reasoning as to why that evidence was rejected and must make particularized findings to support those judgments and allow for meaningful review. Instead, the ALJ immediately concluded that he found evidence that does not contradict the testimony of the vocational expert, and thus the testimony was persuasive. To support this opinion, rather than citing to a specific website or exhibiting the report, the ALJ merely footnoted the homepage of the Bureau of Labor Statistics database. In essence, while appellant offered what would be tantamount to a specific page in the encyclopedia, the ALJ more or less said, I found something that contradicted that finding, just check the encyclopedia as a whole for this evidence. This in no way allows for meaningful review and fails entirely to support the explanation by the ALJ. This is not merely an alternative record. Yes.
Mr. Warren, it's Judge Watford. Let me ask a question if I could. The webs, are you able to hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. I'm getting the same message I got yesterday that says my internet connection is unstable, but hopefully I won't cut out. The BLS website, I agree with you that we tried to find whatever the ALJ was looking at in a search, and that's what I want to ask your opponent here. But I thought the ALJ just simply said that whatever he had found on that website corresponded with the evidence that, was it you who represented the claimant below, or was it someone else?
No, we did represent the claimant below.
Yeah, so you had presented evidence, I think, that showed that there were 25,000 jobs for whatever that was, and your complaint was this insert or position had to be just a small sub part of that, right?
Correct. Basically, the position itself of, I believe it's lens inserter, is one job out of, I believe it's something along the lines of, well, it's a not insignificant number of occupations that fall within that industry. Now, the numbers that we submitted showed that that entire industry had 19,199 positions total, while the vocational expert testimony showed 25,000 jobs in that one single occupation of lens inserter. So,
right. But the ALJ's reliance on the BLS statistics was just to confirm that the 25,000 number corresponded to that larger industry and not the lens inserter position, right?
Correct. I believe that is what that evidence said. Now, the judge then said that means that there could be 25,000 lens inserters, therefore that is sufficient, and he agreed with the vocational expert's testimony after that point.
Right, but that's my point. Isn't the real dispute here between you and the ALJ? It wasn't over the number. The numbers were roughly the same, especially when you factor in the margin of error. The real dispute was, how do we know whether that number corresponds to lens inserter specifically, or whether it's just a small subset of a much larger industry?
Correct.
Okay, and how was the ALJ supposed to resolve that dispute in your view?
In my view, that would be where we would get into the options that the ALJ did have, which were numerous. We have, in the first place, we did request a supplemental hearing so we could actually get vocational expert testimony to resolve that conflict. Another option would have been to send interrogatories to the vocational expert to see if she could resolve that conflict herself. Further, had the ALJ at least even submitted the report itself, we could have seen what that information did entail, and we could have made that determination ourselves, or the ALJ could have, from what we could actually see in that report. So there were additional options that could have been done.
Did you want to save some time for rebuttal?
Yes, I will save 3 minutes for rebuttal.
Yes, I have one question, sure. Mr. Warren.
Yes.
So at this stage, is it your position that we just don't know how many lens inserter jobs there are in the national economy? That I noticed that there was some calculation done, but from the record, I'm not sure anyone knows the answer to that question. Is that an accurate statement?
It is. That is one of the issues that was raised, was that between the direct contradictory evidence that we put in along with the judge's rebuttal, there's no way to know what that actual number is without additional vocational expert testimony.
Go ahead. If you want to finish up that point, then we can hear from the government.
Okay, the next issue that we did have is the ALJ did go do his own research, but he failed to proffer that evidence. He, while it is basically the Social Security regulations themselves require that all evidence relied upon by the ALJ, which is received after the hearing from a source other than the claimant or appointed representative, must be proffered, and the ALJ did not do that in this case. While the regulations do allow for appropriate reference to the evidence, as mentioned previously, the ALJ failed to include either a copy of that report or reasonable means of reproducing the report that he relied on. And while it is true that the Bureau of Labor Statistics is a source Social Security has taken administrative notice of, so is the Bureau of the Census, where appellant information came from as well.
Why don't we hear from the government? You can save the remainder of your time for rebuttal.
Thank you.
Okay.
Morning, Your Honors. I'm Thomas Ellsbury for the Commissioner of Social Security. Good morning, Counsel. So this case, as counsel has said, is about whether substantial evidence supports the ALJ's Step 5 finding, specifically the reliance on the vocational expert testimony. And the case law is clear, and the Act is clear, that the ALJ need only rely on the vocational expert testimony in and of itself is the foundation for their expertise. And the ALJ is entitled to rely on that. There are several issues that counsel has raised that I believe just are not on point for the issue before this panel. The ALJ accepted the new evidence, or the rebuttal evidence, discussed it, as is his responsibility, compared it to the vocational expert testimony, found the vocational expert testimony more persuasive, and in part because the vocational expert relied on at least three different sources for their opinion. Now, counsel says that their rebuttal evidence directly contradicted one source, but I would actually challenge that. The sources listed by that were presented, the first two pages address the lens inserter, but there's no basis, no understanding of how that material came about. The cite to it at the bottom of the page refers to a bookmark, presumably on someone's computer, representing the claimant. That is not accessible either. And as in Bistake, the court held, you cannot rely on just the documentation from these websites because they do not contain all the material.
Mr. Ellsbury, can I just ask you to focus on a different point? What you're talking about really doesn't matter to me. What matters to me is the 25,000 figure. Mm-hmm. The claimant put in evidence that contradicted the vocational expert's testimony because the vocational expert, as I understand it, said there were 25,000 lens inserter jobs. And I'm guessing that you are going to concede that lens inserters are a subset of the, what's the name of that industry? The ophthalmic goods manufacturing industry? So isn't the claimant correct that the lens inserter position is just one of many positions within that overall industry?
Perhaps. It's not clear and it's not established by that evidence. As I said, the basis for those numbers are not presented in the document that Erickson has presented.
Well, then the ALJ, it seems to me, needs to explain to us, explain on the record in a way that we can meaningfully review as to why the reliance on the 25,000 figure for the overall industry is somehow irrelevant to the credibility of the vocational expert's testimony. And we didn't get that. What we got from the ALJ was merely to repeat the fact that, yes, I looked at these BLS reports and they show that 25,000 jobs nationally are available in this whole industry. Mm-hmm. Go see this website that's of complete, you know, of no use because it's very hard to search that BLS.gov website for anything. Maybe you can help us out and tell us where that actual report is, but I couldn't find it. So it seems to me that ALJ needed to give us more than what we have in order to uphold this decision.
In with all due respect, Your Honor, I think there is a false premise underlying this situation, and that is the vocational expert's testimony of 25,000 lens inserters. The issue of whether that's part of the, and it's a hard word to say, ophthalmologic industry or just lens inserters is an issue of evidence to be resolved by the ALJ. And the ALJ, and it's noted, it's in Scheibe notes that, and I'll quote, using the job distribution information in the BLS, the Bureau of Labor and Statistics, or the Census Bureau, which is what Erickson primarily relies on, not the BLS, requires information and inferences not contained in the documents themselves. And that in itself shows the weakness to the evidence that was presented. There was no direct contradictory evidence, one, because the evidence relies on the Census Bureau, not the BLS. 9 of the 13 pages submitted refer to regional or state numbers, and the issue here is national numbers. The ALJ did reference the BLS, as counsel represented, in a generic manner, but he needed to do no more. Again, consistent with Scheibe, it's only the DOT that requires, the Dictionary of Occupational Titles, that requires the ALJ to specify more specifics. That's not required here, because unlike the DOT, it's the BLS and the Census Bureau reports are based on materials, inferences, and data not contained in the document. So it doesn't provide a foundation for contradicting the vocational expert. And the statute and the case law is also quite clear that nothing more is needed for the ALJ other than vocational expert testimony that is based on substantial evidence. And the vocational expert's testimony is that substantial evidence, and their expertise is the foundation for that evidence. And the case law is clear that absent contrary evidence, that is sufficient to constitute substantial evidence supporting the decision.
Can I just jump in? Because I'm just, I'm missing, I think, the point you're trying to drive.
Judge Watford, we just lost you.
If I may go ahead until he returns, or?
Well, let's wait for Judge Watford, because he's, there we go.
Am I back? Okay.
You're back, yeah. But Judge Watford, you'll need to back up to the question, the last question. Oh, we just lost you again. Okay.
Let me stop, and I'll just let you finish, counsel.
Okay, I believe where I thought you were heading was, my point wasn't getting across to you. And in essence, the sole issue here is whether the ALJ's decision is supported by substantial evidence. And it is. Erickson has argued his evidence is directly contradictory. It is not, because as noted in Scheibe, that information alone in a hard copy document is not sufficient to undermine the vocational expert testimony. In addition, as I had noted, the evidence doesn't relate to the issue being disputed. They're arguing that there aren't 25,000 jobs, but they've not presented any evidence that there's less or more, or that the vocational expert's decision is undermined. She not only said that she relied on the BLS, but also market studies and her own surveys regarding this field, and those are not challenged whatsoever. The latter two alone are substantial sufficient basis to support the vocational expert's testimony.
Well, look, can I just ask you one question there? So there is evidence in the record that lens inserter is subset, as Judge Watford had pointed out earlier.
I would say
what do we do with that?
I don't believe we need to do anything with that
So what you're saying then is, although it's a subset, there's at least 25,000 lens inserter jobs in the national economy. Is that the bottom line?
Based on the acceptable vocational and supported vocational expert testimony, the evidence to counter it doesn't establish where those numbers came from. There's no foundation for the 19,000.
What do you do with the fact that there are other job classifications within the broader category? Of 25,000 jobs. I mean, it seems like the ALJ could have cleared all this up with a bit more specificity.
Agreed. He could have articulated perhaps a bit more clearly, but I believe the reference to the Bureau of Labor and Statistics, as counsel noted, a document or a site that we've taken administrative notice of, the ALJ was responding to the additional evidence submitted, the rebuttal evidence submitted by claimant, reviewed this evidence of which we've taken administrative notice, so there was no proffer requirement, and determined that his review of that evidence is that it was similar to the vocational expert testimony. Certainly didn't undermine it, and that therefore he didn't find the new evidence, which lacks citation, and this is very true because it lacks citation. He couldn't really go review that specific evidence, and the evidence that he did see conformed with or supported the vocational expert. And then he noted the other bases for the vocational expert's testimony. And again, that has not been rebutted. So we can take the tables out. That, I believe, is a straw man, if you will. That is not the issue. It's only, it's a challenge to the decision. The ALJ, I'm sorry, that this court has a limited scope of review. The ALJ's decision, according to Scheibe and to Bistek, this court is to, if the ALJ's decision is supported by substantial evidence and a reasonable determination, it's that decision that must be deferred to. And the ALJ has the discretion to make that determination, and he did. And while he could have articulated it clearly, he did say, I'm finding the VE evidence more persuasive based on these three factors as opposed to the evidence that didn't seem to contradict it at all.
Okay,
One quick question here, just to clarify, Mr. Ellsbury. Is it true that the ALJ didn't credit Erickson's numbers, or is it your argument that he did look into them and made a determination that they were wrong compared to the vocational expert's evidence?
I would say more precisely the ALJ looked into it and found it to be consistent with the VE testimony.
Well, if you do some of the percentages, if you're looking in more depth in the Bureau of Labor Statistics numbers, the percentages suggest that there's probably no more than 5,000. There were no more than 5,000 lens inserter jobs in 2017 rather than the 25,000 because of all those other categories that are in the larger code group. And so I'm not sure how we can reconcile that with what the vocational expert testified to.
My response to that would be this was resolved in Scheibe, where, as I mentioned before, the court said there's just too much information and inferences in those documents for us to be able to rely on that. So while it is indicative or suggestive, I would say there is no foundation for that evidence. You can make an assertion, but if you don't support it, and here it's unsupported. If you don't support it, it's not, there's no foundation. And I guess that's what I'm relying on primarily. It is just not a document that we can reach these kind of conclusions. And the ALJ did consider, per his responsibility, the evidence supports his consideration of that evidence, and therefore he should be, his discretion should be given deference by this court.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. We'll hear from Mr. Warren on his rebuttal time.
Yes. So the first point that I do want to make is that the ALJ did reach a conclusion. Obviously, had he felt the same way as opposing counsel, he would not have gone digging for additional evidence to support his side. He saw what was submitted. He determined that that probably would be sufficient to rebut the burden and rebut the vocational testimony, and therefore he decided to look. That is, the judge made the determination on that foundation himself. And then after that, he decided to rely upon evidence that there is no way to verify, where while it might be the case that we do not have the citation itself, we submitted the actual paperwork, the report itself, and the judge did not. Now, it came down to the ALJ did make the determination himself that the evidence was sufficient. As such, he attempted to rely upon evidence outside of the record to resolve that conflict himself. And that is where the error lies.
Anything else, Mr. Warren?
No.
Okay. Thank you very much. We appreciate your arguments this morning, and the matter is submitted at this time.